This video is all about Korea, from the mind-boggling technological wonders of Seoul to the quirky traditions that make this nation truly one of a kind. We'll dive into a world where K-pop reigns supreme, street food becomes an art form, and beauty standards defy expectation. Get ready to be immersed in a vibrant tapestry of unique experiences, because South Korea is a place where the extraordinary becomes the norm. These are 20 things that only happen in South Korea. Number 20. Korean School Uniforms Overview. Now, there is really a long history of school uniforms in Korea. Children have been wearing them in one form or another since before the 1900s. Back then, they were based on the hanbok, which was a kind of standard clothing that was worn during that time. During the 20th century, the uniforms began to get more and more westernized as the clothing, especially with the boys, would be designed to be more like workers' outfits. These days, the school uniform in Korea is much more like Western school uniforms, with blazers and ties and such. Teenagers in South Korea basically wear their school uniform all the time. It varies for each season, but otherwise, teens will sport their school colors every day, and it's seen as a fashionable thing to do since loads of K-pop stars and television actors seem to be doing it. Before we go on, like this video, smash the subscribe button, and click the notification bell right now, or this centipede will crawl on your face when you're sleeping. Number 19. Blood type personality in Korea. What it says about you. Do you know your blood type? It's something that quite a lot of us probably never think about, to be honest. But in South Korea, people are oddly fixated on this question. Is it because they're planning to drain your blood and sell it on the black market? Perhaps they're going to harvest your organs. Well, hopefully not. Usually people in South Korea may ask you what your blood type is because there's a belief that different blood types denote different kinds of personality. It's kind of weird, but probably not much more outlandish than asking someone's star sign. So let's see what your blood type says about you. If you have blood type A, it's believed that you are earnest and sensitive, and you may even be a perfectionist, and you're most compatible with blood type O. If you have blood type B, then you're likely to be creative and optimistic, but also selfish and irresponsible, and you're most compatible with AB blood type. Next up, we have blood type O. These people are outgoing and natural leaders, but they can also be arrogant, and they're most compatible with blood type A. And finally, we have blood type AB. These people are considered rational and talented, but hey, they may also be critical and somewhat eccentric, and they're most compatible with each other. Well, that's very weird, but there you go. If you happen to be in South Korea and someone asks you your blood type, they're probably trying to chat you up. And if you're in a shady bar in Oklahoma, they're probably going to murder you and sell your organs. Number 18. Korea's love affair with sweet potatoes. People in South Korea are just completely bonkers about sweet potatoes. Like, they really love them. You can buy the vegetable from street vendors where they're cooked in their skins and steaming hot, wrapped in a newspaper. In the winter, they're super popular like this and can be found all over the place, kind of like hot dog carts in American cities. The love affair doesn't end there, though. The sweet potato has found its way into everything from candy to yogurt drinks and is seemingly being jammed into new and even more weird varieties of snack foods with every passing day. There are sweet potato lattes, cakes, pizzas, and noodles, and they're all bunged together in masses of different pre-packaged and convenience foods, as well as being grown and eaten throughout the country. It also helps that the sweet potato is having a bit of a moment as a health food, and people are all kinds of excited about the dietary benefits of eating these tubers. Well, it's all very interesting, but it's hardly a thrill a minute, isn't it? What's next? Number 17. Seoul City Bus Stop Traffic Info System. Well, that's hardly the most exciting thing I've ever seen, nor is it likely that it's unique to South Korea, but there you go. This is the way we like to roll here at the Fancy Banana, because at least it's going to keep us on our toes. These are the, frankly, very boring, interactive bus stops that can be found all over the capital city of Seoul, and probably in plenty of other places as well, to be honest. These machines would be installed across the city back in 2015, when touchscreens were not the most ubiquitous objects that they are now. So, this is no longer the newfangled technology that's only found in South Korea. It's basically old hat and dull as a dishwater at this point. That's the thing with these kinds of lists now, isn't it? Time and technology just keeps marching on. And in 2015, it was a really long time ago in many, many ways. Anyways, if you haven't nodded off yet, these bus stops provided locals with real-time information about traffic, transit routes, and nearby amenities, as if we don't all have that in our own pockets on our phones already. Number 16. Valentine's Day in South Korea. Now, like in the United States and everywhere else in the world, February 14th is Valentine's Day in South Korea, but they do things a little bit differently there. In fact, they don't limit the celebration to just one day. Valentine's rituals go on for several days and involve an awful lot of complicated rules and mucking about. If you thought that the requirement to get involved with doing heart-shaped stuff was tedious enough, then feel fortunate that you are not required to get as involved as they do in South Korea. What exactly does all the Valentine's business entail? Well, in South Korea, and also Japan and Taiwan for that matter, women give men chocolates for Valentine's as a sign of affection. But there is a weird caveat to that. It involves an oddly unromantic sounding financial calculation. The women will often choose to spend a lot of money on these fancy chocolate gifts, as the following month, on March 14th, known as White Day, the man will reciprocate the gift giving, but is required to observe something called the Rule of Three, by which he will give her a gift that is of three times the value of the one that he received the previous month. It sounds a lot like the gift companies have nailed the ridiculous market for this stuff by extending Valentine's and making up a bunch of rather pricey sounding rules. They say that this response will demonstrate how a man feels about the relationship, and if he doesn't give her a gift, then it says he is above her, and if he responds with a gift of equal value, then the relationship is over. And if he responds with a gift of thrice the value, then it's all a go. Sounds like a lot of horse shiz to me, but you know, if you do get dumped by being given a box of chocolates, then it's all a bit of a mixed message anyway.
Valentine's Day. Meron ding White Day, March 14.
All of the gift rule shenanigans don't stop there. It's also customary to give chocolates to all kinds of people, but the quality and the fanciness of said confections is basically a hidden message that can mean anything from I love you with all of my heart to I think you're a proper plonker. It is a tricky business. In addition to all of that stuff, you'll also need to use a lot of white stuff on White Day. And then of course, if you don't receive a gift on either of those days, well, there's a day for you as well. Black Day is where all of the sad single people will go to a restaurant and eat black noodles and cry about how lonely and sad they all are. No, I'm serious. That's exactly what it's all about. Number 15. A Novice's Guide to Norabang in South Korea. A Norabang is a Korean-style karaoke room. They are extremely popular and can be found all over the place. These rooms are rented by the hour, and mostly people can just turn up and get involved, so there's no need to book in advance. You can just feel that urge to get to singing as soon as the music takes you over, or the booze, which is more likely to be honest. These places vary massively in amenities and fanciness. They cost anywhere from $5 to $25 and can be extremely shabby or very fancy indeed, with posh decor and complimentary ice cream. Prices change depending on the time of the day that you choose to visit. It is cheaper to go and belt out a few power ballads in the afternoon than it is in the evening. And while there is, obviously, a lot of Korean language music, there are also plenty of the usual suspects in English as well. Almost all of it's from the 70s, 80s, 90s, and 2000s. The main thing with these places is to bring plenty of enthusiasm and also to take turns. Because nobody likes a mic hog. I'm looking at you, Twinkle. That's right. Ugh, my pet guinea pig is such a diva. Number 14. Choreography and flash mobs. Back along, there was a time when everybody was watching the prisoners in a Filipino prison doing huge choreographed dances in the name of exercise and rehabilitation. It had nothing to do, of course, to have internet-y clicks, but it was a moment in time when you could barely move for a flash mob leading to life in front of you while you were minding your own business just waiting for a train or doing whatever. Most of the world got over the massive choreography and flash mob craze, but apparently South Korea has a bit of a soft spot for these things. Koreans really, really love flash mobs, and they can be seen dancing suddenly, or a whole orchestra might even spring up in the railway station. Naturally, the Korean phenomenon of K-pop doesn't miss an opportunity to get in on the act, although most flash mobs are regular people just dancing to their favorite songs. Sometimes the real pop stars can't help but get their mob on too. Then, of course, there are the hideous marriage proposals, which draw enormous amounts of attention to a young woman, like in the middle of a department store, where everyone suddenly breaks into a choreographed dance routine like they're in a Hollywood musical or some such nonsense. But there you have it. South Korea is a big fan of the flash mob and mass dancing routines. What do you think about all this coordination? Do you enjoy a good flash mob? Let me know in the comments section down below. Number 13. Why are there no trash cans in Korea? Korean culture has many distinct traditions and ideas. It's a culture of respect and values, and one of the ways that this can be seen is the way in which people are expected to keep their environment orderly. There are, oddly, given this notion, very few public trash cans. In fact, it can be almost impossible to find one at all. In Seoul, the government had actually removed thousands of trash cans to stop people from putting their domestic rubbish into these bins instead of paying to throw it out in the expensive municipal collection service. It is a perennial problem finding anywhere to throw stuff away in this country. So, what do people do with their litter? Well, it seems that the rules and manners regarding cleanliness mean that people will simply hang on to any rubbish that they may have until they can either get home or find a suitable place to dispose of it. There are, of course, waste bins in many places, but they're not liberally scattered through the streets. The best place to locate a trash receptacle is in a subway station, where there are likely to be large cans for all of that trash to go in, or in subway station bathrooms, where there are smaller ones for paper towels and such. If you do use a convenience store and eat the food there, then you as a paying customer will likely have access to a trash can. Otherwise, you're likely out of luck and will be carrying your garbage around, probably for days on end. Number 12. Do Koreans have school at night? Apparently, Korean high school students have a 16-hour day. If that doesn't chill you to the core, then you should probably also know that the average amount of sleep for students in grades 10 to 12 in Korea is only about 4.9 to 5.5 hours a night. Yeesh! What the heck is that all about? The actual school day begins generally at around 8 a.m. and ends officially at 4:30 p.m. A longish sort of day, but nothing too extreme. It is the extra stuff and additional studying that almost all the students do that's adding on all those crazy hours and the lack of sleep. School in South Korea is extremely competitive and stressful. The expectation placed upon students in Korea is enormous, and they're under massive pressures to perform. Many children's and young people's days are micromanaged so that they use every second to be educated or enriched in some way with school, extra study sessions, extracurricular activities, musical instruments, you name it. These kids are not getting any downtime anytime soon. Number 11. Korean barbecue. Korean barbecue essentially consists of the experience of cooking some sort of marinated meat on a grill that's then placed in the middle of the table. There are many different variations involved in the Korean barbecue, but it basically refers to the method of cooking cuts of marinated meats. These can actually be marinated in a whole different variety of ways, often including soy sauce, sesame oil, and something else, and then the meat is grilled. There are many barbecue restaurants in Korea where the grill is built right into the table itself, and it is all about the experience of cooking the food as much as it is eating it. As well as all of the meats, there are plenty of side dishes that accompany the Korean barbecue. These can include stuff like kimchi, rice, vegetables, and all the usual things you would expect. So, as well as the meat and the side dishes, there are also some other components that make up a Korean barbecue. There's something called sesam. This is when you wrap the meat and vegetables in leaves, and these can be lettuce leaves, perilla leaves, or even sesame leaves. And then there's a sauce called sesamjang, which is made of soybean paste and red pepper paste. Sometimes there's also a stew of fermented bean paste towards the end of the meal. And naturally, there are also plenty of drinks. The traditional drink is soju, which is Korean wine. And there you have it, that's Korean barbecue. Number 10. Beacons help pregnant women get seats on Korean trains. This was a pilot scheme on trains in South Korea that aimed to make sure that pregnant women who wanted a seat would not have to stand on public transport. Women were able to pick up these beacons, which were essentially gadgets that would then detect when she was standing near a seat and would trigger a pink light to turn on and let people on the train all know that someone needed a seat, thus offering them the opportunity to vacate their own. It was a nice idea because it removes the perennial problem of fearing that you might offend someone by offering them a seat. You know, in case that's a food baby that they're carrying. But it was only available on one particular train line, and therefore wasn't even something that people would even know existed. Number 9. Korean tailors and the New Year wardrobe. Like many parts of Asia, South Korea celebrates the Lunar New Year. There are, naturally, many traditions and rituals that are specific to this country for the occasion, but some have been gradually fading out in favor of newer and more modern celebrations. One of these older traditions is the wearing of a special outfit called hanbok. This is a two-piece outfit that is usually made of either cotton or silk and beautifully embroidered. They're worn by both men and women. Families will get together in a new hanbok outfit to mark the holiday in a traditional manner, but this style of celebrating is gradually becoming less popular. Naturally, the drive to keep the tradition of hanbok alive is being piloted by tailors of South Korea. This would have been a major source of income for the traditional clothes-making professions, and this is changing the face of the industry, as well as causing a waning of traditions in general. Number 8. Couples in South Korea wear matching outfits. Now, opinions are divided about significant others wearing matching outfits. For some, this can seem to be the cutest thing in the world, and for others, it's just disgusting. You probably have a general idea about how you feel about it as well. But in South Korea, this is a weirdly common practice amongst loved-up couples. It dates back to the tradition of newlywed lovebirds sporting specific clothing that would let the world know that they had just gotten married and were crazy in love. They would traditionally sport a suit for the guy and a hanbok for the lady, but in more recent decades, that tradition has been replaced with matching outfits. These days, the tradition has been adopted by couples who aren't jostled to express the same sort of sentiments and to demonstrate their couple-y status to the whole entire world. Talk about rubbing it in. That's why, when you're in South Korea, you're highly likely to see a young couple dressed in the same or even coordinated outfits. Appearances are massively important in South Korea, and fashion plays a big part in that culture, especially amongst the younger population. This is just an extension of that, and also a way to sell more stuff to young people, if we should be honest. But what do you think about these matchy-matchy shenanigans? Would you style yourself to match your other half? Let me know what you think in the comments section down below. Number 7. Sparkling public restrooms. Public restrooms can be found everywhere in South Korea, apparently. In fact, it seems to be a matter of pride that they have as many sparkling clean and ultra-modern restrooms as possible. These can be found all over the place. Some of them have those super fancy toilets with all the gizmos, like the ones that are popular in Japan. With a whole bunch of buttons and snazzy features, super toilets are much more than just a receptacle for bodily waste. These things provide more services than a luxury car wash. Even the basic models offer the sitter a range of wondrous delights as anal cleansing, bidet washing, deodorization, and the utterly essential seat warming. How the world has survived without such basics is a mystery to me. We've all simply been living like animals, and it's time we stopped parking our posteriors all willy-nilly without a proper bottom-washing facility, let alone on a chilly old chamber pot. The sheer number of buttons and options are likely to boggle the basic brain, so before you engage with a tech toilet, make sure that you clear your schedule or you simply won't have time to explore all the wonders of multiple flush options. Which are based on the specific type of deposit that you've made. Or how about the integrated bidet selections with the inspiringly titled choices of oscillating, pulsing, and rear/soft functions? You'll wonder how you ever lived without it. In fact, the toilets in South Korea are so diverting that you could easily spend all of your time there touring the lavatories. Number 6. Eating live octopus. Apparently, this is a thing that people in South Korea are really super into, and some of the more adventurous visitors to the country also seemed oddly eager to try it. If eating a live octopus is your thing that you're into, then who am I to judge? And you should probably acquaint yourself with some of the dangers of such a niche gastronomic experience. To begin with, when you're munching on the live octopus, although really, do you want to do that? It does seem rather rude to not even allow the animal the dignity of being dead first. You're going to need to chew properly, or else its suckers are going to get stuck in your throat on the way down. Stuff stuck in your throat, you may or may not be aware of, can cause you to choke. Apparently, there's a way to eat the octopus that makes it less dangerous, but possibly not much less gross. The chef prepares the poor creature by removing the mucus from its tentacles and then cutting them into small pieces so that they can cause less of a choking hazard. So that's all well and good, but even still, it's a live octopus. What the hell are you even doing? Number 5. Seoul City Tour Bus. Well, here we are in a catch-22 kind of discussion. I did promise you things that only happen in South Korea, and in some respects, this is a thing that only happens there, but it's also a thing which happens in literally every other major city with any kind of tourism credentials on the whole entirety of the planet. It is all a matter of perspective, I suppose. I mean, you can only tour Seoul, South Korea when you're in South Korea. But taking a bus tour is hardly breaking news. So make of this what you will, and then decide if we fancy bananas are, as I suspect, complete and absolute lunatics. Number 4. Gym Jobangs in Korea. Saunas are a big thing in South Korea, not the same as the Swedish kind, of course. That's why they have a different name. The hot, sweaty places are called gymjobangs in this particular country. So what can one expect to find at a Korean sauna? Well, these places are basically the traditional Korean bathhouse. They offer stuff like hot and cold pools, saunas, massages, and stuff like that. It's a big part of the culture in Korea and is enjoyed by people for all kinds of social reasons. The families go together, as do couples and even friends. They're places of relaxation and meditation, and in Korean culture, they're believed to do wonders for your health. From improving your circulation to managing your weight, these facilities make a whole lot of claims. They are gender separated, with men using one side and women the other. Oh, and everybody gets naked. Now, before getting into the pools, everyone has to scrub themselves silly. This is the etiquette, or they would all be soaking in gross people soup. Hygiene is massively important to Koreans, so there's no skipping this bit. People may even come over and scrub your back, just to make sure that you're nice and clean. There are sleeping areas in these places, so you can even get some shut-eye once you've had a good wash. Number 3. Is dog on the menu in South Korea? Traditionally, eating dog has been part of Korean culture for centuries. In recent times, though, the popularity of this practice has been significantly reduced. In a recent poll, the vast majority of people who were asked about this traditional food culture responded that they had never actually eaten dog meat. Given the controversial idea of this in many Western countries and the spread of Western culture, it's hardly surprising. Dogs are rarely on the menu here anymore, and more than 60% of people are actually in favor of banning dog meat altogether. The government is currently looking at legislation to make this become official. Number 2. Soju Explained. What is it and how do you drink it? Soju is the national drink of South Korea. It is a spirit that is traditionally made from rice, although these days, the majority of the stuff is actually created from various other grains like barley or tapioca, or even sweet potatoes. This was because during the Korean War of the 1950s, in order to protect the food stocks, the Korean government banned the use of rice to make soju. There is a lot of etiquette that surrounds the drinking of the beverage. The youngest person at the table is supposed to pour everyone's drinks, and then you should accept your glass with both hands. It's also important that your glass is never empty. You should always leave some in the glass to show that you don't want a refill. Otherwise, you're going to find yourself that you keep getting topped off. It is also a faux pas to pour your own soju. And finally, when you say cheers with your drink, you should never make eye contact. Number 1. Is Korea a workaholic? Korea has a bit of a workaholic culture. This is a country where it's expected that people will work overtime on a regular basis, but they do have a statutory working day of 8 hours and a working week of 40 hours. The thing is that it's seen as a virtue to work extra hard, and therefore the expectation is that people will do so. The corporate culture in South Korea has a lot in common with that of other famous workaholic nations like Japan. So that may give you an indication of the expectations here, although there seem to be greater protections in place, and there's still a cultural stigma surrounding a working life and the necessity to be seen doing long hours. This begins in school, when, as we have seen, children and teenagers are required to fill every waking hour with schoolwork, homework, and extracurricular activities. That's all from South Korea for today. How did you find these weird and wonderful things? And which of them was most surprising to you? As always, let me know all your splendid thoughts and ideas in the comments section down below. Be sure to check out the other cool stuff that's showing up on the screen, and I'll see you next time. I love you.